Amen. Okay, so open up your Bibles. If, again, you don't have a Bible, by all means, you can grab one from under the seat. Or, of course, you've got a phone. You can probably find it somewhere on your phone, I'm sure, as well. Well, we are coming to the end this morning of a series that we've been in for the last number of weeks on the parables of Jesus found in Matthew chapter 13. And on this Easter Sunday, we give thanks to God for the fact of the resurrection of Jesus. But on this Sunday, we're also wrapping up this series. And so we're going to look at two small parables as we bring the Parables of Jesus series to a conclusion. And here's the two parables. I'm going to read them to you. They're found in Matthew chapter 13, verses 44 through 46. Here's what Jesus says. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value went and sold all that he had and bought it. Now these parables that I just read, like most of the other parables in Matthew chapter 13, they all begin in a very similar way with the statement, the kingdom of heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven is like. You can see that in verse 44. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in the field. You can see it in verse 45. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. The parables that came before this, some of them that came after that, it's the same thing. The kingdom of heaven is like. Jesus has lots to say about the kingdom. But before we look at the point, the main driving point of those two parables, I want to spend some time addressing what Jesus taught about the kingdom of God outside of parables. What did Jesus teach about the kingdom of God? And I want us to turn to a text that actually, I believe, helps us understand these two parables in particular from the life of Jesus. So if you want to turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 1, verses 14 through 20, we're going to hunker down in this text for a good portion of this message. And from this, we're going to discover what it is that Jesus is really driving at in the two parables that are listed there in Matthew chapter 13. Here we begin in Mark chapter 1, verses 14 through 20. We read that after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men. And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat mending the nets. And he immediately called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and followed him. How does this text help us to understand the two parables that we've just read in Matthew chapter 13? Well, Mark gives us three truths, three really important truths about Jesus that help us to understand those two parables. And I want to give you those three truths this morning. First of all, in the text in Mark chapter 1, I want you to notice Mark refers to the king's message. Right at the very beginning of the gospel of Mark, he tells us the message of Jesus. In verses 14 and 15, notice what he said. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. Jesus' proclamation centered on the kingdom of God. That was what he preached. When Jesus came and proclaimed the gospel of God, he's proclaiming the good news. That's what gospel means, the good news about or the good news concerning God. The good news concerning God is that the time is fulfilled. All that was said in the past has now come to fruition. It's now in the person of Jesus who is here proclaiming that the kingdom of God is now here. It's at hand. The kingdom is here because the king is here. He's arrived. From the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, He taught extensively about the kingdom of God from beginning all the way through to the end. In fact, I would say that the kingdom of God is the number one dominant message of Jesus all through the Gospels. There's a lot of things Jesus talked about, but everything Jesus talked about falls under the sort of bigger, broader umbrella of the kingdom of God, because that was the driving message of Jesus. It's always amazed me sort of in church life that over the years, so little attention is given to the kingdom of God in churches, in sermons, when Jesus gave so much attention to the kingdom of God. It was the core of his teaching. But not here. We talk about the kingdom. That's why we're preaching through the parables. Right here, even in Matthew's gospel, the text that we're in with the two parables, Matthew uses the word kingdom 59 times in his 28 chapters. And in the majority of those incidents, the kingdom that he's referring to is a present reality because King Jesus is there. He is on the earth with the people. The king is there. Now, when you study the kingdom of God in Scripture, it becomes evident that there is both a present form of the kingdom because Jesus, the king, is there, but there's also a future sense to the kingdom of God as well. We're looking for and anticipating the sort of ultimate fulfillment, the final arrival of the kingdom when all will be said and all will be done. And since Jesus' arrival, the kingdom he has taught is growing, actually. It continues to grow, it continues to expand, and it will do so until the very end. And here in the Gospels, Jesus speaks of that presence of the kingdom, and he also speaks of our need to enter into the kingdom. So the king is here, the kingdom is here, but he talks in so many passages about the need to enter into that kingdom. And how do you enter into that kingdom? And he also addresses the issue in all of Scripture of how to live under his kingdom, rule, and reign. You see, because if he's king, then he has a right to rule, right, doesn't he? And he wants to rule and reign over us as a good and faithful and loving king. So what exactly is the kingdom of God then? Well, let me put it this way in a quote from George Ladd. He said, the kingdom is basically the rule of God. It's God's reign, the divine sovereignty in action. God's reign, however, is manifested in several realms, and the Gospels speak of entering into the kingdom of God both today and tomorrow. God's reign manifests itself both in the future and in the present, and thereby creates both a future realm and a present realm in which man may experience the blessing of his reign. So the kingdom of God then is, it's the rule of God, or you could say the reign of God. And as king, Jesus rules and reigns then over his kingdom, doesn't he? And as Christians, if you think about this, we desire to be, in fact, we are subjects of his kingdom. We desire to be loyal subjects of King Jesus, subject of his rule and reign in our lives. We want to see his rule and reign in our lives in what way? We want to see it manifest in our hearts. We use that to say sort of on the inside of us, don't we? Like we need the inside rule and reign of Christ in us more than anything because everything starts from the inside out, according to Jesus. We desire, for example, to see his rule and reign in our homes, don't we? I mean, that's where we really need to see that manifested in our homes. We need to see it manifested in our church, in our country, and in our world. We need to see it everywhere. But the primary place we need to see it is right here, inside our own lives. Lord, reign in me. Reign in me. Jesus, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. One of the realms over which you want to rule and reign is me. Me. You see that? He's after our hearts. He's after your heart. He's after my heart. He wants our heart more than anything. In Luke chapter 17, verses 20 and 21, we read that Jesus was asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, and he answered them, the kingdom of God is not coming in ways that can be observed. In other words, don't expect some big, huge physical manifestation of the kingdom, nor will they say, look, here it is, or there, behold. Jesus says, behold, the kingdom of God is in the midst of you. In fact, some translations in the Greek, you could actually render this not just in the midst of you, that the kingdom of God is here because King Jesus is here, but the kingdom of God is actually within you, within you. One of the realms over which Jesus desires to extend his rule and reign. You know, we talk about this morning already. Jesus has been raised to life. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. In other words, he is in glory. He's currently ruling and reigning from heaven. But one of the realms over which he wants to reign is us. So in verse 21, he says, the kingdom of God is in the midst of you, or the kingdom of God is within you. That means when a person accepts Jesus Christ as their king, that's what takes place. Lord, reign in me. He becomes the king of your life. His rule and reign begins to be seen in you. His rule and reign takes manifestation, if you want to put it that way, in you, where he starts changing you from the inside out. Now, I don't know about you. For me as a guy, I find that the message that Jesus is king really resonates with me as a man. And when I know who Jesus is and I know that he's the king, I don't have a problem at all with seeing King Jesus, not as a wimpy guy dying upon a cross, who's sort of painted by Hollywood as this blonde-haired, blue-eyed, kind of, you know, nice-looking guy. I see a rugged Jesus in Scripture, a real Jew who's got the beard, who's been a carpenter. He's appeals to a little bit more sort of, I guess you could say, of maybe me as a guy, and then I realize that he's my king. Well, I don't have a problem at all with going like this to Jesus and taking a knee for King Jesus. Like, he is my king. Like, why would I not want to surrender and subject my life to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? You are the sovereign Lord of the universe, the ruler of all, the conqueror of everything. You're going to bring everything in subjection to you, Lord. So, yeah, I don't have a problem with bowing to you in the least. I gladly do that. Because who am I? I'm a servant of the King. And not just because I'm a pastor, but because I'm a Christian, that's why. Because I'm an actual follower of Jesus. Because that's what actual followers of Jesus do. They actually surrender their life to the King. You know, I don't have a problem with surrendering myself to King Jesus. So that's what the message was that Jesus preached. But I want you to also notice in verses 15 that Mark refers to the king's invitation. So he gives the message, the kingdom of God is at hand. He wants them to know. The people that were listening to Jesus, they understood what he was talking about when he talked about the kingdom. The Jews had a long understanding historically about the kingdom of God. And the way they thought of it or conceived of it was not always the same way Jesus taught about it. But nonetheless, they were familiar with the idea of the kingdom of God. But Jesus here in verse 15 gives his invitation to those who are listening. Notice in verse 15, he says, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. And then he says, repent and believe in the gospel. That's the message and the invitation now of the king. His message is to repent. It's also to believe in the gospel, that is, in the good news that the king is here, that Jesus Christ is king, that the kingdom of God has come in your midst. The idea of repentance is the idea of turning, isn't it? It's sort of like, okay, the people that are listening to that message on that day, they'd heard Jesus, they may have been wandering in this direction, going this way, they were walking in this way. Repentance is the idea of turning, right? It's a turning or a changing of direction, changing of your mind, and you start heading in this direction. So I'm living in sin, or I've got sinful things. I'm not walking with God. I may be far from God. I may be no better than that I should be living differently, because maybe I'm familiar with the message of Jesus. But nonetheless, life gets us, right? We fall into pits and traps, and we start heading in this direction. But repentance really is that, right? It's not Jesus saying, hey, it's okay. Like, I get it. You know what? Just keep doing what you want to do. He's like, no, repent, turn, and come follow me. Turn. Repent and believe. Believe in the good news concerning Jesus. You know, Jesus had a man appear to him at night one time, didn't he? In the Gospel of John, in chapter 3, his name was Nicodemus. And what did he say to Jesus? Or what did Jesus say to him? He said, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born again. There is an entry point, right? If this line that's here that you probably can't see on the stage, but it, trust me, it's here. I could trip in it, which would be entertaining, wouldn't it? But if I have to cross the line at some point, don't I? Like, if I'm going to become a Christian, if I'm going to enter into the kingdom, the idea of entrance must be that there's a threshold, right? There's a crossover point. I have to cross over. Jesus invites people to enter into the kingdom. And how do you enter in? Well, this passage tells us, doesn't it? This passage tells us there's an invitation extended by Jesus. He preached the message of the kingdom. He told them, I'm here. Your king is here. Now turn from your sin and believe in me and enter into the kingdom. You see, that's what it means to really be born again. You know, the guys that hold the signs at the football games or whatever, you know, John 3:16, or, you know, you must be born again signs, wherever. Well, they're saying what Scripture says. We may not like their method sometimes, but they're saying what Scripture says. The reality is Jesus taught that, right? He said, if you want to be in the kingdom, you've got to be born again. It's a miracle of God. It's a work of God in your life where he takes you from what you used to be and he changes you from the inside. But it's through the power of the gospel of Jesus. And then thirdly, in verses 16 through 21, I want you to notice, Mark refers to the king's followers. The king's followers. The one who proclaims the kingdom of God, that is Jesus, and calls people to repent and believe the good news, is now walking beside the Sea of Galilee, where he meets four fishermen, and he calls them to repent and believe. Here's the account, starting in verse 16. Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat, mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and followed him. That was their response to Jesus. In this text, Jesus calls Simon and Andrew, and then he calls James and John in this text. Now, it should be observed that this is actually not their first encounter with Jesus, likely. There was an earlier occasion when they had bumped into Jesus in the Gospel of John. We read about that account. And at that time, Andrew introduces Simon, that is his brother, to Jesus. But at that time, Simon didn't follow Jesus. Simon, who later became Peter, no, he actually went back fishing. He was introduced to him, but he went back fishing. He was not ready to follow, but during the second encounter that we read about, that's in Luke chapter 5, we discover that Jesus meets the disciples. They're out. They've been fishing all day. They catch absolutely nothing, and Jesus comes up to Peter, and they clearly know each other, and he said to Peter, why don't you just, let's put the boats back out there again. And so he said, all right, we've been fishing all night and we're exhausted, but okay, we will do it. So he puts the boats out, they go out into the sea, and he says, cast out your nets, and they pull in this massive load of fish. And Peter, at that point, finally realizes who Jesus is, right? He finally sees it. He sees that Jesus is the one who's the king. His response, in fact, is, depart from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. I'm a sinful man. So the way that these men responded to Jesus when he called to them is that they first repented and believed. We certainly can see that. Peter, his response is, Lord, depart from me. I'm a sinful man. I really am. You see, and that's part of it, right? For us to enter into the kingdom, there has to be an acknowledgement that I'm a sinful person. Frankly, there's nobody in this room who's not a sinner. I'm a sinner. We're all sinners. And we just might as well just accept it and get on with it, right? And realize that what we need is somebody to help us with our sin, and that's Jesus. So we need to repent of the sin and turn from it. But notice their response. It says that they immediately leave their nets. That's the second thing they do. They immediately leave their nets. Now, why would they do that? Why would they respond this way to Jesus' invitation to follow him? If I said to you just what I said this morning, are you going to go out and just quit your job? No, right? I don't think so. And I would say, don't quit your job. Okay, please don't quit your job. And don't say that I asked you to quit your job. But it looks like that's what they're doing here, right? It looks a little bit like these guys have just sort of like, okay, they heard about the kingdom. They've been invited to repent and believe. And now they immediately left their nets and they're following Jesus. And now they just follow Jesus around all day. There's more to the story here, though. There's more to these accounts. And this is where we start connecting in the parables in Matthew 13. You see, when they heard Jesus preach about the kingdom of God, his call to repent and believe, and his invitation to follow him, they immediately did leave those nets as fishermen. And why did they do that? Because they understood with crystal clear clarity the inestimable value of the kingdom of God. They understood the worth of the kingdom. They understood the value of the kingdom. They understood that the kingdom of God and King Jesus himself as a person has absolutely no comparison. There's absolutely nothing to compare the worth and the value of the kingdom of God. Those first followers of Jesus in Mark chapter 1 were like those Jesus describes in these two parables. Let's read those again. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value went and sold all that he had and bought it. Jesus preached the kingdom, didn't he? And he invited people to enter into that kingdom, didn't he? And the disciples responded to that kingdom by immediately leaving their nets and following Jesus. You see, because like this parable, the disciples were like the man that found the treasure hidden in the field. They were like the merchant in the parable that were in search of fine pearls and found this one pearl of great value. When you find something of incredible worth and incredible value, you will gladly give up everything for it. And notice what this text says in verse 44. Then in his joy, he goes and sells. It's not as though it's like, oh, crud. This Jesus guy has come along and I got to give up all this stuff. Whatever, I'll do it. I feel the weight and the demand and the burden of this. That's not the picture here. That picture should be erased from our mind. There is the joy of discovering Jesus, King Jesus, and the kingdom that Jesus is ruling and reigning over. And when you and I get a picture of the kingdom of God, we get a glimpse, a snapshot of Jesus, and we really see him for who he really is and what his kingdom is really all about. Why in the world would we settle for anything less than Jesus? That's the thing. Friends, I'm not here to sell you on Jesus. I'm here to just simply tell you that Jesus, there's nothing and no one that compares with Jesus. Nothing. No one. And I can't make that happen for anybody. The Lord does that. But I do know that when you start looking at who Jesus is, there's just something about Jesus. When life starts falling apart, the ground caves in from among below you, the roof falls apart on top of your head, life hits you hard, when everything gets stripped away and ripped away, when you face horrible things in your life, whether it's health or relational, what happens? When all anything else is gone, what have you got? The kingdom that you've built or erected comes all crumbling down, and you recognize that what I really need is the kingdom of God, and I need King Jesus. So what's the point of these two parables? John MacArthur puts it this way. He says, both parables make the same point. A sinner who understands the priceless riches of the kingdom will gladly yield everything else he cherishes in order to obtain it. He goes on to say that the gist of both parables, the kingdom of heaven, is only for those who perceive its immeasurable value and are willing to sacrifice everything else to acquire it. One must embrace the kingdom with a whole heart, with the zeal of one who gladly forsakes everything to buy one treasure more precious than anything else he or she could possess. The kingdom of heaven is rich beyond comparison. It encompasses Christ and all that he offers. Eternal life, unending blessing. It is incorruptible, undefiled, unfading, and infinite. Its value far exceeds that of the world's richest treasures or finest pearls, yet its richness eludes most people. When Jesus' first followers then heard Jesus the King proclaim the kingdom of God and his invitation to enter into the kingdom, we are told that they immediately left their nets. Why? Because they knew that there's no other kingdom that can ever come close in comparison to the kingdom of God and Jesus the King. Now, on that day, did they literally walk away from their nets to never pick them up again? One might think that, but when we study the Gospels, we realize it's actually not the full picture. You see, what happened is a radical shift took place in their lives. As R.T. France put it, he, that is Jesus, now takes precedence over livelihood and family. That's the shift. In practical terms, there were clearly limits to this renunciation. You know, they renounced, they said, we left everything to follow you. Peter would make that kind of declaration. At least for some of the disciples, there's texts like John 21 that suggest that Simon retained the use of a boat and fishing tackle when occasion required. I mean, what boat do you think that they used when they went out with Jesus? I mean, they were fishermen. You get the picture of what's going on, right? In verse 29, we find that the house of Simon and Andrew is still available for their family. They didn't leave their house. They didn't say, okay, here, somebody else have it. They still had the house. They were still married, some of them. They didn't say, well, forget it, we're going to follow Jesus. Wives, sorry, but Jesus has come. You know, they make the claim, right, that they've left everything. But I think the point that we're supposed to understand from that is that the abandonment of the nets does not represent a decisive change for lifestyle. The point is that they've shifted, right? They are now like this. I think when you bend the knee to Jesus, you're now saying, Jesus, we're leaving everything. So how are we leaving it? Well, the nets now are yours, Lord. The boat is now yours, Lord. My house is now yours, Lord. Like, the way I lead my family is yours, Lord. Like, there is not a single thing in the kingdom of God that the king doesn't want to take in your life and repurpose for his glory. And that's what the disciples did. They understood with clarity that when they accepted Jesus Christ the King, it wasn't that they had to stop fishing and ditch that. In fact, they went back to fishing, didn't they, after the resurrection? Or before, when he died, they went back fishing. And then they met Jesus again while they were in their fishing boats. So what they did is they had a radical shift in the way they looked at all of their stuff, right? All of their wealth that they might have, all of the possessions that they might have. See, a follower of Jesus, now his or her whole life gets reoriented around the kingdom of God and no longer around their kingdom. A life that's once lived for myself, doing what I want, when I want, how I want, my own autonomy. Nobody tells me what to do and when to do it and how to do it. Jesus the King comes and you bend your knee to Jesus and say, Jesus, not my will but yours be done. You are the sovereign Lord, the King of kings. You're the King of my life. I gladly bend my knee to you, Lord Jesus. What is it that you want from me? Because in joy, I want you and I want your kingdom. And he says to you, I want you to take everything that you have and I want you to think about my kingdom. So, you know, years ago when my wife and I were looking for a home when we had first moved to Utah to plant a church, our biggest thing for us was just like, we want a home that's got usable space so that we can have people over because this is God's home. This is for his kingdom. You see, that's the mindset that God wants us to have, a kingdom-minded, kingdom-centered people because of Jesus. Everything in life, you see, so that your life and my life isn't about coming to church once in a while. It's actually about the radical reorientation of the kingdom of God in our lives centered on Jesus the King, so that absolutely everything, there's nothing in your life that's untouched by King Jesus. That, friends, is true Christianity, right? That's true Christianity. So the question then is, why settle for lesser things? And people settle for lesser things all the time, sometimes simply because they don't know anything about Jesus. That's a big part. People often pursue a kingdom, but not the kingdom of God, with King Jesus on the throne of their lives. People who have once maybe came to church or had some sort of shape or form of a relationship with Jesus, put him on the shelf, and they're not living for the King. But there's always a new day. There's always an opportunity to hit the reset button. But why bother with any other kingdom? The kingdom of man. It comes to an end, doesn't it? I mean, look around us. You look at the news and you look at sort of the kingdoms, if you want to put it in that world. It's a mess out there, isn't it? I had a conversation with somebody not too long ago at a Starbucks, and they wanted to dive me into politics, which I avoided like the plague because I wanted King Jesus to be brought up, not King whoever. And I just had made the comment that, you know what, in times like that, when the world looks like such a mess, I agree, it's such a mess. Boy, but one thing I know is that there is a God who rules over all. He's a Lord of all. And the person said, I don't believe that. And I said, how can you not believe that? Right? I know you look at the mess, but I also know that you claim to believe in the God of the Old Testament. He is the Lord of all. But why settle for lesser things? Sometimes the real issue is that we have acted and lived as though we are kings and queens over our own lives. We want to rule ourselves well. Think of King Herod when Jesus was born. He was threatened by the birth of a little baby. Why? Because somebody was saying he was the king of the Jews, and, well, nobody's going to come and topple my kingdom. He's a man that went to such degree that he would even execute his own wives, because he had several, and his own children, if he had any fear that they would try to topple his kingdom. You see, in a sense, we don't have to have a literal throne as people that we rule over, do we? We can really set ourselves up as individuals, as sort of the king of our own lives. Right? Nobody gets to tell me anything. You know, you realize how I got to where I got in life? I pulled up my own bootstraps. I did my own thing. I'm a self-made man. I'm a self-made woman. Little do they know that the only thing, everything that they have is actually not because they're self-made, but because the God of heaven granted them the privilege and the blessing to be able to even have the mental and physical or whatever abilities to attain and to acquire. They need to do is acknowledge the King. So why settle for less? A long, long time ago, there was a man named King Solomon. And he was the king, and at one point, we read in Ecclesiastes how he had really built his own kingdom. And I don't mean just his literal kingdom over which he was king, but he was king in his own heart. Notice the things that he pursued. He pursued so many lesser things in life that were just meaningless in the end. He said this in Ecclesiastes 2, I said in my heart, come now, I will test you with pleasure. Enjoy yourself, but behold, this also was vanity. I said of laughter, it is mad, and of pleasure, what use is it? I searched with my heart to cheer my body with wine, my heart still guiding me with wisdom and how to lay hold of it, till I might see what was good for the children of man to do under heaven during the few days of their life. I made great works. I built houses and planted vineyards for myself. I made myself gardens and parks and planted in them all kinds of fruit trees. I made myself pools from which to water the forest of growing trees. I bought male and female slaves, and had slaves who were born in my house. I had also great possessions of herds and flocks, more than any who had been before me in Jerusalem. I also gathered for myself silver and gold and the treasure of kings and provinces. I got singers, both men and women, and many concubines, the delight of the sons of man. So I became great and surpassed all who were before me in Jerusalem. Also my wisdom remained with me. And whatever my eyes desired, I did not keep from them. I kept my heart from no pleasure, for my heart found pleasure in all my toil, and this was my reward for all my toil. I mean, listen to the I's in there, right? I did this, I. I mean, this is a man who is so full of himself, isn't he? So full of himself. But notice his conclusion. Verse 11, then I considered all that my hands had done and all the toil I'd expended in doing it, and behold, all was vanity and a striving after wind, and there was nothing to be gained under the sun. You know, friends, we're told in Scripture that our life is like a vapor. It's like a mist that appears for a while and then vanishes. It's like a flower that withers and dies, right? It's like a shifting shadow. These are all sort of metaphors of Scripture about the brevity of our existence. So why settle for lesser things? Why build and erect our own kingdom instead and exchanging the most valuable kingdom with the greatest king for an empty, shallow, man-made kingdom that we build in our own lives? All Jesus asks is that you would say yes to King Jesus. Have him as the king of your life. So he had it all, but he realized that in the end it was all pointless. And we want to make sure that before our end, we don't arrive at that conclusion and say, what was the point of all of this? But it's too late. For this reason, on this Easter Sunday, I want to invite you, in fact, to consider King Jesus. To consider the kingdom of Jesus. Consider what King Jesus has actually done for you. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, the Apostle Paul put it this way. He said, I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, that is Peter, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. Those first disciples were eyewitnesses of the death, burial, and resurrection of King Jesus. And they went around and they boldly proclaimed the message of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus everywhere they went. One time they attempted to shut them down in the early parts of the book of Acts, and their response was, we cannot stop speaking about what we have seen and heard. Friends, when you know who Jesus is and what he's done for you, you cannot help but speak of what he's done. What you've seen and heard. So I want you to consider the invitation of King Jesus. That invitation that's found in Romans chapter 10, where Paul says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the Scripture says, everyone who believes in him will not be put to shame. Maybe you entered in here today and you have this uncertainty about, like, well, am I really a follower of Jesus, or what they call a Christian? Am I really that? Like, I don't know. Or maybe you entered in saying, oh, I know I am. I am. But maybe you heard this message and you're going, I'm not sure if I am. You know, I'm of the viewpoint of just like, If God is speaking to you about something, you just go with it, right? And we sometimes just have to be able to say, Jesus is inviting me, just like he did those disciples in the very beginning, to take a step forward and cross that line, like I said, enter into the kingdom. But there has to be a decision to cross the line. There has to be a decision. And you may not be ready for making a decision about King Jesus today. You may not be ready, and that's okay. What I want to encourage you to do, if you find like, you know, I'm not ready, I'm kind of wondering what this is all about, I want to encourage you to talk. We believe that this is the truth. Otherwise, I wouldn't waste my life doing this. You want to talk about the resurrection? Did Jesus really rise? I'd love to talk to you about that. And the mountain of evidence about his resurrection. I'd love to talk about, you want to talk about the Bible, whether it's reliable or trustworthy? I'd love to talk about that. Most people don't get this information. We want you to know that wherever you're at, we're here, and we'd love to have conversation and engage with you in a loving way just to try to help you any way we can. That's all. And if that helps you to take a step closer to Jesus, great. If you need time to think about it, we're not in any hurry for you. We just want you to know that this is what we do and who we are, and we just are glad that you're here this morning. But maybe you're here this morning and you are like, you know, I want to cross that line. I want to ask Jesus Christ. I want to confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in my heart that God raised him from the dead. I want to give you an opportunity to do that. It's not going to be an awkward opportunity. I'm not going to do that to you. What I'm going to do, though, is I'm just going to pray a prayer that you can quietly follow along with me. You don't have to pray it out loud. You can pray, you can say in your mind, as I pray the prayer, you can agree. But it's just a prayer, a simple prayer of inviting Jesus Christ, the King, to come and take up his rule in your life. So if you believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, if you believe that he was buried for 3 days and that on the third day he was raised to life, then I want to invite you to pray with me and invite Jesus Christ, the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords, to come into your life that you might enter the kingdom. And so all I'm going to do is I'm going to just ask that we bow our heads in prayer. And if you'd like to do that, just pray with me. Lord Jesus, we are here in your presence. And you are our King. I know that I'm a sinner. And I need a Savior. Jesus, you called me to turn from my sin and follow you. So that's what I'm doing today. I want to turn from my sin and follow you, Jesus. Lord Jesus, would you come into my life? Would you please forgive me for all my sin? Would you begin to rule and to reign in me? Change me. Transform me, make me the kind of person that you want me to be. And thank you, Lord, for the joy of being able to know you. In Jesus' name, amen. If you did pray that prayer with me this morning, I would invite you at some point to say something to someone. You can say it to me, to somebody else maybe you came with, but also on that card that's in front of you, you could fill that card out. You could just put a note, your number. You could drop it into that blue offering box. You could bring it to the back. We'd love to chat with you. We just want you to know that we're delighted that you're here and want to help you in your spiritual journey all the way along. God bless you. It's great to be with you.